I don't know. I'm so scarred from trying to give outlooks, and then, you know, it becomes this obsession that people want to beat you with. So look, I'm very positive. Obviously, I think we go well through new all-time highs. You know, I think the whole ecosystem of crypto, we go from 425 million users where we are today. I think the end of this cycle will be 1 billion users by the kind of use cases we've talked about. Don't forget, we've got CBDC, stable coins. There's a lot going on still. So, you know, if the entire space is going to grow 2.5x in number of users, well, market cap of the entire space is 5 or 10x. So, you know, you can figure it out from where that is. So, yeah, look, I'm just very positive. And then let's see how people value layer twos in this. You know, we don't really know how value twos accrue as much value. Do we have to have a massive amount of transactions? In which case, then you need stuff like Ticketmaster with millions and millions and millions of transactions to drive value to those chains, because they batch them and then batch them down to ETH. So look, it's super fascinating. But yeah, I don't see anything different this cycle than we've seen in other cycles for any particular reason.
Raoul Pal expresses an exceptionally strong belief in the entire cryptocurrency space. However, he singles out two specific coins that he anticipates will outshine the rest. The first is Ethereum, a choice he considers to offer the most favorable risk-to-reward ratio in the entire crypto landscape. Furthermore, there's another coin that he believes may potentially surpass even Ethereum in performance, though it comes with a higher level of risk, Solana. In his recent interview, Raoul elaborates on why he holds such bullish sentiments for both Ethereum and Solana and outlines his expectations for them in the upcoming cycle. Don't miss the conclusion of the video, where Raoul breaks down various crypto catalysts on the horizon, including the spot Bitcoin ETF and the Bitcoin halving. Additionally, he shares insights into the advice he would give himself if he were just entering the world of crypto today.
I observe the space, kind of trying to step back from it, because too many people get too involved with what they like because they like it and they're part of that thing. But I just observe Solana, and I think I've mentioned it in the show before, is like, I see Tolly as a thought leader. He's accepting of others around him. He builds bridges, doesn't destroy them. I see a very engaged developer community, and people are really, really passionate about building their ecosystem and building their technology. And there's a lot of people who use it, and there's a lot of public awareness of the chain. So why Visa using Solana? Because it's fast. You know, it's fast. It does a good job. It's not Ethereum. It's different to Ethereum. And even the way that Tolly has been talking about, you know, could Sol be a layer two on ETH? Or, you know, how do these worlds integrate? Just shows that, you know, for Visa to make a wrong decision is not that easy, because things can be bridged, things can be interoperable, life can move on. So, you know, I've just been just observing that. And Solana space has not foot wrong for a long time now, just when everybody had maximum fear and hate over the space. Now, also, you're getting rid of the FTX overhang. You know, the thing that people didn't like is that FTX was such a big owner. Well, that goes as well. So for me, it's a great story. It's still probably the best major story in the space outside of Ethereum, because Ethereum's the big daddy. But if we're looking at the next stage down, you know, where's the next altcoin that has relative security in it? You're not taking a wild guess. You're not saying, yeah, Helium's going to go up 1,000x. You might be right, might be wrong. But Solana, if the space grows, will Solana do well? Probably. It's a smaller chain, so $100 of capital in Solana will move the price more than $100 of capital in ETH versus $100 of capital. So its liquidity drives it higher. And the higher it goes up, obviously, the more people are interested in the chain as well. So it feels the right thing. Now, it doesn't mean I'm right. I think it's going to be the applications layer. It's what can you do with NFTs that is not monkey JPEGs or fine art? What else could you do? How does ticketing work? How do these broader use cases? How's the financial system going to integrate? We're seeing lots of noise from the financial system. You know, the two big parts of adoption for me is the financial system and brands and culture. So the financial system, we know they're sniffing around every single investment bank, every single asset management firm. You know, London Stock Exchange has just announced that they've got a group working on tokenizing securities. What people want to do is get securities on chain, because it's a faster, more efficient, capital effective way of doing things. So I think that's what they all want to get to. So that's huge. That's trillions of dollars that flows through those markets. The other side is brands and culture and that kind of stuff. So that's sports, entertainment, fashion, luxury, that kind of stuff, plus music. Those are the big cultural pillars of our societies, and they have a lot of opportunity to use this. And we're seeing it from everybody from Starbucks to Nike to Adidas to Chanel to, you know, Balenciaga to Mercedes-Benz to. So I think they're all trying it, testing out things. But if Formula One would get it right with NFTs in some sort of kind of cool format that's not just an NFT, but gives you unlocks and does different things, well, there's a 1.6 billion Formula One fan. What happens if football got it right? You know, soccer, there's like 3 billion fans. So These things are massive. So it's those two that I've got my eye on. What those applications are going to be, I don't know. Are we ready with all of the wallets and all of the basic stuff that we need? We're getting close. Not quite there. Still a pretty crappy experience. A lot of people can abstract it away. Like Ticketmaster have issued more NFTs than anybody in the world. Nobody knows this. They've issued 30 million NFTs because their wallet, the Ticketmaster wallet that you get when you go to a gig or you go to a sporting event, that ticket is actually in a Web3 wallet. The ticket's not an NFT, but they drop NFTs into your wallet. So, hey, thanks for coming to the concert. Here's an NFT memento. And they're building a social graph out, right? This is clever stuff. You know, the scale of what Starbucks are trying to do with their loyalty program. Interesting. We've seen other airlines look at loyalty programs. So this is what I think it is when it becomes abstracted away. We're not talking about what chain it's on. We're not talking about, you know, 10,000 NFT collectives. I think they were just the proof points en route to something much, much bigger. It's difficult because we all learn lots of different lessons as we go, but are they applicable this time around? You know, it's like before, it's like, I don't really know what NFTs I could buy and how to get that right. But then I've continued to buy NFTs. So I don't know if I've learned a lesson there or I just want to prove out the thesis that NFTs are lagged assets. And as the ecosystem grows again, more money comes in, then NFTs are like trophy assets. It's like, it's really interesting to watch the chart of Rolexes and NFTs. They're like one for one because nobody's got any spare cash right now in the real economy or the token economy. So these things kind of grind lower because people haven't got money to buy trophy assets. I think the one thing I have done is, last time around, I tried to put a basket together of smaller tokens that were interesting to me, you know, that last time around, whether it was the avalanches or whatever it may be, I just held a basket and thought, let's see if that worked. Didn't really work, actually. I was surprised. Didn't really work as a strategy. So I'm more concentrated than I've ever been. And I'm quite comfortable with that. Just saying, listen, I'm going to stick with what I know. Now, there might be something that I find that I really want to go, but I'm not going to FOMO into this stuff. I mean, I didn't do a lot in any of this stuff. So it wasn't very costly, but it distracts you. You know, when I look at who made the real money, it's the people who made the concentrated focus bet, you know, and got it right. Or if they were getting it wrong, got out, switched their thesis fast. Don't get caught in a narrative of some small token because you feel like part of the community and you don't really know how it's going to do, unless you really have true insight into demand, network activity, things that really drive value. Just keep it simple. Keep it to the top five, something like that. Just don't overcomplicate. I see so many people on Twitter who are so entrenched into a token, they have no idea whether it's going to work or not. And it's like, you're in one of the biggest trends of all time. Just don't fuck up. Just buy the basic stuff that you should buy and maybe have your degen money, 10% of your money on the side to say what an amazing trader you are. But don't miss the big picture because you will be so angry with yourself if you miss it. So I think the Bitcoin halving is actually to do with the macro cycle. It's the debt refi cycle that happened in 2008. In 2008, we had a great reset of debt. What happened is every central bank, major central bank around the world said, right, nobody needs to pay interest. Interest rates are zero. Okay, that was fascinating. Then they kind of agreed that nobody was going to pay off debts. So they just keep rolling them. And what they did is back in 2008, they all issued debt between 3 and 5 years. That kind of 4-year midpoint is the halving cycle, because Bitcoin launched at the same time. So they're coincidental. Now, maybe it's one of the reasons Bitcoin, you know, can outperform because of it, but really the cycle is a macro cycle, which is really important for people to understand. But you can still use the Bitcoin halving cycle because of the same timing. So it makes no difference. You don't have to over-intellectualize it. It's just like, yeah, January 2024 should be an up year unless something dramatically has changed. My strategy is, I did most of my buying last year. I never sold a single thing. The idea was, the journey I've learned since 2012, 13 was, if your thesis is long-term, stay with that. But then in these, if you think of that logarithmic trend, is when we get these down cycles, the macro down cycle or the halving cycle, that's when you add and it compounds over time. So that's all I've done. Now, you know, when I've got more cash, I'll probably still add a bit more, but that's my main thesis. And I'm just sticking with that. Just keeping it super zoomed out. As you said, keep the emotions out of it. Ignore 90% of the news. Observe it, but don't feel part of it. That's a really big thing to learn. Is Binance going to go bust? Is that going to happen? None of it matters. It's just, all that does is change the path of that. You know, does it go down and then up and then down? I don't know. But what's the probability that the space is significantly higher in 10 years, knowing what we know, knowing that the financial system wants to use it and all the brands that want to use it, and that central banks want to issue central bank digital currencies and stable coins are being adopted around the world? The probability of this being much higher is extremely high. Just focus on that. Yeah, I became successful, or I had the path to success, when I started to try and understand why people think, not what they think. That is the game of markets. It's the game of life itself. Why is somebody angry with you? Normally, it's something that they've got that's being questioned about their own self-identity. It's usually not to do with you. Learning that why stops you getting emotional about stuff and you become more analytical about stuff. And you can step back and observe everything going on. And that helps you in your journey of life in every way, in how you operate with people, how you run a business, how you deal with your parents, to the opportunities that come your way. So I found that is a really, really powerful tool. So it's twofold. You know, generally as 20 years old, you don't have enough money to make money from your investments. So income is king. Figure out how to make income. And from income comes everything. This old generation now thinks it's all about passive income, which is bullshit. There's no such thing. You know, you end up with an Airbnb of which everything keeps breaking and costs you money. And then, you know, there is no passive income. Go out, figure out ways of income streams. And then when you've got income streams that exceed your cost of living, so keep your cost of living low for as long as possible, you can then invest. And then if you're young, you invest in the longest duration asset. So that's at 20, it's like crypto, technology, those kind of things. It's like you can take the risk. You've got an income stream, so you're safe. And then for me, it's a path that's not most obvious for others, is then have some goals of where you're going. So I always had a future vision of myself. Now, those things change and shift around, but somewhere that when you're up at 6 o'clock in the morning, you're thinking, this is why I'm doing this. This is where I'm going. I find that really helps. And then take lifestyle profits en route. So for me, that is when I first bought a house that I owned outright, I knew I could, and it was in Spain. I knew I could work at a bar in Spain and the world could burn and I would have a house and I'd be absolutely fine. The sun would shine 300 days a year, the olives would grow outside and the oranges would grow and life was pretty easy. That is such an unlock. Because then from a place of security, so income's the first security, then somewhere to live, which is, I know it's expensive these days, but it doesn't have to be in the country you live in. You could, you know, buy a shack in Nicaragua, cost you 100 grand, but it's yours. And you can work with a laptop from anywhere. So, okay, these things are game changing. Because once you've got security of income and security of life, you can take as much risk as you want. And then the journey becomes fun. Look, I know everything feels either dull or boring or it's not happening. Don't force the narrative. There's a reason people use the terminology hodl or hold. It's for this. It's like, don't degen just for the sake of it. Stay with the big picture. You know where you're going. If I ask anybody watching this, what is your conviction that Bitcoin or whatever is going up a lot over the next 5 years? My guess is the answer would be, yes, of course it is. But when you ask them, is it going up or down next week or the next month? You know, the views splinter because people have no idea. So why even play that game? You don't need to play that game. And if you need to do it because you love a bit of gambling and adrenaline and you're bored, I can see people trading meme coins or anything just to get some adrenaline back into them because we all live on adrenaline in this space. Just do it with 10% of your money. Just put the rest aside on your ledger and just leave it. And then you can go meme-tastic or NFT crazy.
Here's Raoul Pal sharing his approach to the upcoming crypto bull run. Raoul underscores that the crypto journey is a mix of opportunity and risk. With expert advice and knowledge in hand, navigating these turbulent waters becomes a deliberate adventure. Whether you're entering the world of crypto for the first time or seeking to strategize like a seasoned investor, the insights shared today can serve as your foundation for well-informed decisions. For more Daily Dose Crypto news, check out these two awesome videos on your screen. Click now and we will see you on the next video.